Hello viewers, I am back again and we will continue our discussion on the legacy of printing. In this episode, we will basically discuss the popularity of books, newspapers and magazines, right? How printing proliferated in different countries and how the entrepreneurs ventured into printing different kinds of publications depending on the demand from the readers. So let us concentrate on books first, and books we will see in different countries, how different countries specialized in publishing different kinds of books. That's what we are going to see first. We will begin with Netherlands. Now, Netherlands has been a seafaring nation. The Dutch mariners reached different corners of the world. They even came to India. We have Dutch settlements in India, right here in Bengal also they settled down. And in order to navigate their way through the seas, they needed very good maps. So the Dutch printers actually gained an expertise, they developed an expertise in printing maps, which were beautifully, they were just like works of art, beautifully engraved, detailed on names of all the places with arrows showing all the routes, the names of all the countries, etc., etc., with all the details. And the person particularly who made a name for himself in printing maps, his name is Willem Janszoon Blue. And his maps are really works of art to look at. And they are excellent examples of geographical science, typographical skill, and the engraver's art. And actually, maps of that standard have not been made. Even in the present day map printing, you won't find maps of that particular standard which the Dutch had attained at that point. Now, in France, King Louis XIII, he was a great patron of printing. And France, the administration was more centralized. The spirit of free enterprise was not there so much in France. So as a result, the entire printing endeavor was also centralized and controlled by the king himself. So the king, Louis XIII, he set up a printing press in his Louvre palace where he lived, and a number of famous books were published from there, the most famous being the complete works of Voltaire. Voltaire was a very renowned poet. So all the copyright for all the manuscripts of written by Voltaire bought from him for 160,000 francs. And with that, with all those manuscripts, the collected works of Voltaire was published by King Louis XIII's printing press. In England, again, we will encounter a spirit of free enterprise and a number of private entrepreneurs setting up their printing presses. All the publications in England were not of very high standard because, you know, the kind of people they employed, slipshod editing, not accurate proofreading, so there were typographical errors, etc. But still, in the 18th century, England also 17th and 18th century, there were a number of very significant poets and writers who lived in England and their works got published. Who were they? Shakespeare is one person, then Milton is another person. Then a number of copies of King James's Bible were printed, and I think every English family owned one. One English book that became instantly popular and successful, and thousands of copies were sold, the name of that book is Pilgrim's Progress by Bunyan. Then in England, at Oxford University, when Dr. John Fell was the Vice Chancellor, he set up the Oxford University Press. And the Oxford University Press acquired distinction in publishing academic journals and books of academic importance. Notable is Anthony Wood's Historia et Antiquitates from University of Oxford. And the Oxford University Press is, even today, they are very active in bringing out textbooks and books of other books of academic interest. We move on to Spain. And in Spain, one single book that actually took the entire, not only the Spanish, but all the Europeans by storm, that book was Don Quixote. It was a 17th century book, Don Quixote, written by Cervantes. Now we come to some specific books with far-reaching impact, books and authors. We begin with Petrarch, who was an early Renaissance period thinker, philosopher, and writer. Now, Petrarch wrote not only in Latin, he was also very prolific in writing in his native Italian language, and that's how he made that Italian language very popular among the common people. Some of his notable books are Africa and also a series of sonnets on a mystery lady called Laura, you know, with whom Petrarch evidently had fallen in love and the love was unrequited. So this Laura series of poems became very popular, very plaintive poems of unrequited love. And of course, Petrarch was a very prominent philosopher, so his heavier books, more serious books are also there. So here you see a manuscript, because the era of Petrarch, when Petrarch lived, 1304 to 1374, the printing press was not yet invented. So this is his manuscript, and after the invention of the printing press, the same books came out in print, and then it reached more people and more people enjoyed Petrarch's work. We come to Niccolò Machiavelli. Machiavelli is often called the father of political science, because he was not only a philosopher, he was a very political thinker, and how to rule a state, how to keep subjects under control, how not to lose power, how not to let go of power from one's hands, all these things Machiavelli theorized on. So he wrote a number of books. Some of the more famous books are The Art of War, which came out in the year 1573. And the book that made Machiavelli really notorious was called Prince. In fact, Prince was printed 5 years after Machiavelli's death. After writing Prince, he earned a lot of negative feelings from his colleagues and collaborators, because the prince actually says how a statesperson or a prince can actually have you know, strategic tactics to keep himself in power and keep himself at the top of his kingdom. Okay, so if not everybody liked the tone or the frankness with which Machiavelli wrote the Prince, so see, he earned a lot of enemies, in fact, after writing Prince. And here is a quote from Prince: "He who neglects what is done for what ought to be done sooner affects his ruin than his preservation." So like that, very true but very uncomfortably true statements are there in Prince. Then we come to two absolutely landmark books which brought about the scientific revolution. One book is called De Revolutionibus by Nicolaus Copernicus, and the other book is called De Humani Corporis Fabrica, that means the fabric of the human corpus, human body. Now, De Revolutionibus is a book that writes about the heliocentric system, that demolishes the geocentric system, and it puts the heliocentric system in place. The Earth and the other planets are going round the sun. Now, Copernicus was actually a monk, and he was a timid monk, and he was very scared about what he discovered through his night sky watch and through his calculations. He was very scared to share it with the people and bring it out in public. So he wrote the manuscript of the book in 5 parts. Book 1, Cosmology. Book 2, Principles of Spherical Astronomy. Book 3, Sun. Book 4, Moon. And books 5 and 6, Astronomical Objects in the Heliocentric Universe. He wrote the manuscript and he was too scared to give it for publishing. He wrote a simplified and abridged version, made limited prints of that, and distributed it among his peers and his friends. And they were also quite, you know, shaken to say, oh my God, the at the center of the universe, we don't have the Earth. The sun is at the center of the universe. I mean, they also couldn't reconcile themselves with this idea. But then eventually Copernicus he thought that before he dies, he must give it out in public domain, whatever be the consequences. And it is said that when the book finally was printed, he awoke from a stroke-induced coma. He held the book in his hand, newly printed book in his hand, and died peacefully. The point is that De Revolutionibus is such a difficult book that very few people read it at that time, and it really didn't capture the attention of the priesthood, of the clergy, of the church. But then some people who read it, and they were absolutely swept away. They were overwhelmed by these new thoughts and new ideas. One of them was Giordano Bruno, who stood at the street corners and tried to propagate, popularize the new ideas of Copernicus. And people didn't accept it. People took him as a heretic and they burnt him at the stake. Okay, so that was eventually the result of taking Copernicus's legacy forward. Similarly, Galileo Galilei had to face the Inquisition. He was not burnt at the stake, but he had to face the Inquisition. Now, Galileo Galilei spent sleepless nights observing the stars through his telescope, and he kept meticulous records of what he saw. You know, he wrote and he also drew about the phases of the moon, about the planets of the moons of Jupiter and the rings of Saturn and so on. Then eventually, Galileo wrote a popular science book, that this may be called the first popular science book, which is called Dialogue Concerning Two Chief World Systems. He wrote this book and in Italian so that more people could enjoy it. It immediately caught the attention of the Pope, and for this book he had to face the Inquisition. The book was eventually banned, and Galileo was asked not to write anything as long as he lived. Can you imagine that? So that was Galileo's fate, but then Galileo today is accepted as the father of modern science. So that's how the new ideas were slowly ushered into the society and slowly gained acceptance in society. Now we come to life science, and the person who revolutionized ideas in the science of medicine is Andreas Vesalius. Now, Andreas Vesalius was a medicine man. He was also a surgeon. And just as Galileo was obsessed with the night sky and the heavenly bodies, Andreas Vesalius was obsessed with the human body. It is said that he even stole dead bodies in order to carry out dissection and study the anatomy. Now, dissections were done those days in medical, you know, medical students had to do dissection, but how the dissection was done, you know, a surgeon would do the dissection, the students would sit around and stand around, and the professor would sit at a higher platform on a pulpit, and he would read out from Galen's book. Galen was a Greek medicine man, so from Galen's book he would read out, and the pupils would listen to that and they would see the dissection. So all those inconsistencies that were there in Galen's books never caught the attention of these doctors till Andreas Vesalius paid attention to them, and he wrote this De Humani Corporis Fabrica in 1543. The book got published. It had a lot of illustrations of the human skeleton and the human body, the human nervous system and so on. And of course, it had the writings also. The publication, the responsibility of the publication was taken not by a private entrepreneur, but by the medical council of in Padua. He was a professor in Padua. So the medical council in Padua took the responsibility of publishing this book. And what are the new ideas that were given out in this book by Andreas Vesalius? Number one, that Vesalius demolished Galen's age-old belief that blood flows from the liver. Everybody earlier used to think that the liver pumps the blood. So he demolished that idea, and also he demolished the idea that the human body has basically two types of blood, good blood and bad blood. So these two age-old ideas he demolished, and he gave his new theories in the book that he published. So these are the revolutionary books that changed the way human beings understood themselves and understood the environment around them. We now turn our attention to the changing conditions in the publishing industry. The Copyright Act of 1709, which is also called the Statute of Anne. This Copyright Act was passed in the British Parliament, the Parliament of Great Britain, and it was a revolutionary move because for the first time, it gave the author the respect that he is the creator of an intellectual property, and therefore it is his right to hold on to this intellectual property and to sell the intellectual property rights to the publisher if, as and when he wished it. Okay, otherwise to enjoy the right of this his intellectual property as long as he lived. Okay, so for the first time, the author was given this intellectual property right by the Statute of Anne. Now, the Statute of Anne was also useful for the publishers, because now what happened is that nobody could pirate, you know, nobody could just pick up any author's manuscript and give it for printing, okay. So, all these piracies stopped. So, therefore, the publishers approached the author, they purchased the copyright of the book from the author, and then after this, they set a price to the book, and for the sale of each copy of the book, the author got a certain royalty. All right. So the author kept on earning from his book as long as he lived, and the publisher also made his profit. And if one publisher purchased the copyright of the manuscript, then nobody else could touch that book. So that way, piracy was stopped. Okay. Multiple publishers publishing the same book, that was stopped. So therefore, the author was liberated from individual patron. Earlier, what happened, either the author just wrote the book in his spare time, or he was commissioned by a nobleman or a king or a rich person to write a book on a particular topic, and he was given a certain amount of money. So the author had to write words of praise on his patron, about his patron, pages and pages, without, you know, much of which would be a lie, or without knowing, he would just praise that person blindly, because after all, he's giving money to the author to write on a certain topic and so on. So now the author didn't have to depend on individual patrons like this. Instead, the author could make a living by selling his copyright and getting also getting the royalty from the sale of books. So it changed the living condition, it changed the business condition, it changed the equation between the author and the publisher, which is a very important thing. Now, Samuel Johnson, he has said about this individual patron, the patron is a wretch who supports with insolence and is paid with flattering. Okay, so Samuel Johnson hated writing flattering things about the patron. So now he didn't have to do it once the business relationships changed. Now, until the middle of the 18th century, it was considered bad manners to get paid for what you wrote. You write for reputation, or you write because you have knowledge. Why should you get paid for it? Okay, so Erasmus again was a late Renaissance scholar. He was a humanist scholar. So many people told Erasmus that, oh, you wrote your books because you were paid by the publisher. Erasmus was very much offended by that, and he kept on defending himself that he did not, whatever he wrote, he did not write for money. He wrote because he had to share his ideas and so on. But then later on, of course, it became a common practice for the author to accept money for what he wrote. So the reading public increased. As the literacy increased, the reading public increased. And so the book libraries proliferated, the bookshops proliferated. People went to the bookshops, they spent hours there, they browsed through the books, and then they invested in buying books. So one would find books in homes of very, very ordinary people, of peasants or of workers, okay, of craftsmen. There would be books, and in their spare time, in their leisure time, they would read books. So the reading, the habit of reading was growing. Libraries were coming up in different parts of Europe. People were going to the library, spending time in the library. And the particular genre that really became popular was the novel. People loved reading the novel, particularly ladies, they loved reading the novel. Now, books were not the only things that were published and that were that became popular. Calendars or almanacs, those were also very popular. You know, a calendar of events and with some words of wisdom and with some forecasts about the weather and things like that. Those were bought by every ordinary household. You know, once a year they would buy that and they would keep it and they would refer to it. All right. This habit is there even in India, ponjika as we say. So almanacs were also in great demand, and everybody bought an almanac once a year definitely. Newspapers and periodicals. Okay, slowly books diversified into newspapers and periodicals. Now, what is a newspaper? How do you define a newspaper? A newspaper has to satisfy four criteria. It has to be reasonably accessible to the public. That means it has to be cheap enough so that everybody can buy it. Number two, periodicity. It has to come out at a regular interval. Number three, currency. Currency means that it has to discuss about current events, contemporary events. And number four, universality. There has to be something of interest for everybody. For the politically minded, for the women who would read the stories, there will be comic strips, there are the sudokus, okay, there are book reviews. So there has to be something for everybody. So that is a newspaper. And if going by all these criteria, media historians have said that in 1609, this German paper Relation, that was the first newspaper to be published. Actually, later it was found that it was published in the year 1605, a German newspaper called Relation. And the second newspaper, the second oldest newspaper is, that is also German, Avisa Relation oder Zeitung, which came out periodically. It didn't come out every day. Actually, daily newspapers came much later. The oldest newspaper that is still published since 1645, and that is still published, that is the Oxford Gazetteer, okay, which came out from the Oxford University Press, Oxford Gazetteer, and that comes out even today. The world's first broadsheet to be published is that is defunct now. It was first published in the year 1618 and it became defunct in the year 1664. And here is a year 2000 Y2K German postage stamp which is commemorating the 350th anniversary of the first daily newspaper, which is again a German newspaper. The first daily newspaper. Prior to this, the newspapers came out once a week maybe, or twice a week, something like that. All right. There were these evening newspapers also. Evening Mail, Evening Courier, Night Mail, okay, which came out thrice a week. And those were very punctual because they were dispatched. These were all British English publications. And the English railway service, the mail service was used to dispatch these papers all over England, to the countryside, to the other cities and so on and so forth. All right. So they came out to catch with that particular mail through which it would be dispatched to the remote corners of the country, to remote corners of England. So these evening newspapers also came up. And from smaller sizes, it increased to broadsheet, what today we know as broadsheet. Cornettos are typical publications, newspaper-like publications, which are again broadsheet, and these are for announcement. These were initially publications by the administration, by the state, but very soon, because these are not expensive to publish, these became a vehicle for activism of the activists, those who wanted to say, protest against a particular ruling of the state or protest against the state. They use these cornettos these are like pamphlets, to popularize their point of view. And one such very famous cornetto is Milton's Areopagitica, where he lashed out against the licensing policies for printers and publishers. So he gave an impassioned speech which came out as a cornetto and which was distributed freely among the people. Okay, so here is a glimpse of these newspapers from various countries, England, Russia, Ireland, etc. Many of these have stopped publication, but some of these, like the Oxford Gazetteer, etc., are continued even today. These are the publications from America, because the American press was also growing. So this is the 1721 publication from Boston, which was distributed in 13 colonies. Today, this is defunct. This is a newspaper from South America. This is an 1825 edition newspaper from South America. And here you see Vladimir Lenin reading the newspaper Pravda, which was the Soviet publication, the Pravda. And then this actually, when newspapers became popular, the word newspaper gained currency later on. Initially, these were news books. All right. But because from books, books were more expensive paper and with a proper title page, etc. But these news books, they used cheaper quality paper, very quickly printed so that these were accessible and these were cheaper and people could buy. So these news books used to come out once a week or once a month. All right. Then slowly these news books diversified into newspapers on one hand, which came out every day, and periodicals or magazines on the other hand, which came out weekly or sometimes fortnightly or sometimes monthly. So this is the weekly periodical, which is the Saturday Evening Post, which was very, very popular. It was meant for the entire family. It had a lot of interesting illustrations. It discussed contemporary topics. There were news and features and discussions and interviews and so on. So extremely readable and extremely popular. So this is one example. But there were other fashion magazines and the other kinds of magazines, travel magazines, etc. Also very, very niche magazines were also there. And this particular magazine, the Gentleman's Magazine, it was continuously published from 1731 to 1907. And it reached a circulation of 10,000 in the year 1739 and 15,000 in the year 1745. So this is one of the more popular magazines, the Gentleman's Magazine, which remained in circulation for about 200 years. And this is the Gentleman's Magazine of Fashion. As I told you, there were fashion magazines also. So Gentleman's Magazine of Fashion. So we see that in the 18th and 19th centuries, the reading public increased in number. They created demands for different kinds of reading material. And people started reading in their leisure time, that it became a pastime. Okay, they started reading in their leisure time. And the publishers rose to the occasion, they cashed in on this demand, and they came up with various genres of publication to satisfy the ever-increasing demand of the reading public. So thank you very much. I hope you have enjoyed this lecture.